afternoon, everyone. As a dean of the School of Music, it's a great honor and pleasure for me to welcome not only all of you here and people in the community and other aficionados of new music to this presentation by the 2011 Grawemeyer Award for Music Composition winner, Louis Andriessen. The Grawemeyer program of awards is really one of the, to use an overused phrase, crown jewels in the university's professional and community presence. The Grawemeyer Awards, as many of you know, were founded through a sizable gift by a graduate of the University of Louisville, Charles Grawemeyer, in 1982. The endowment that then was created has been able to fund five awards, of which the Music Composition Prize was the first. Other prizes in psychology, education, world order, and religion, which we award with the Louisville Presbyterian Seminary, followed that of the Music Composition Award. For many of you that are aware of the award, and perhaps some of you who are not quite so intimately familiar with it, the winners of that award have their photographs against the west wall of this first floor. And so I invite all of you to inspect in great detail the luminary composers who really make up the leadership in many respects of contemporary composition post-1950 through the present. It really is a remarkable collection of winners, all of whom contribute in important ways to our programs here and benefit not only our music composition program and our composers, but also all of you. The impact of this award is consonant with our school's predisposition and support of contemporary music, of composition, and all of its manifestations. And we really feel like this particular award gives us this sort of imprimatur, the motivation to continue to support new music in all its forms, not just those of the winners of this composition prize, but rather all of them. And many of you that are composers or played music by our student composers realize the special energy and special value that playing new music can bring. So we're very pleased to share this prize with the rest of the world, where it has become known internationally as one of the singular important prizes in music composition, certainly one of the first and among the richest prizes. So it's with a great deal of pleasure that we invite this year's winner to be with us here this week in advance of the regular Grawemeyer winners, which come to campus in about 2 weeks. As you might suspect, the reason that Mr. Andriessen is here early is because he has other responsibilities in London during our regular Grawemeyer week, where the London Sinfonietta will be performing a concert dedicated to his music, which will include two pieces which will receive their UK premieres. So we're very fortunate that we've been able to work out with him an opportunity for him to come to Louisville to accept the prize this afternoon and to talk about his winning piece, which is an opera based on Dante's Inferno, Commedia. It's a multimedia work which I believe was premiered in this country in 2008, I think is correct, and which has certainly joined the ranks of the important operas being written certainly in this century, and whose power I think will impress you, and whose insights which he will share with you today certainly match those or are consonant with the founder of the award, Charles Grawemeyer, who really wanted this award to celebrate the power of new ideas and important ideas. It's not a lifetime achievement award. Rather, it's an award that's given to a particular work, whether it's a book or in this case a piece of music, that embodies important transformative ideas, in this case in music composition. And so while each piece speaks individually in its own language, each shares a common bond with previous winning pieces of being unique and special in its expression of what it expresses and how it expresses that idea. And so we're all the benefit here in Louisville of Andriessen's presence with us this afternoon, but also all the winners that continue to contribute and inspire our students and our faculty and our community to the power of musical ideas. The coordinator of the Grawemeyer Award for Music Composition is Professor Mark Satterwhite. He's been in that role now for, I think perhaps 6 years or thereabouts. And so he's very much responsible for organizing all the forces, not only in our community, but also internationally, that work together to review the some 160 or so pieces that are submitted, nominated each year, which are then winnowed down and selected by a community lay panel for the final winner. And so this is a huge task, one that takes really an entire year to begin. Next year's nominees are already under consideration. And so I hope you'll join me in recognizing and thanking Mark and also welcoming him to the stage for the introductions of the 2011 winner. Mark.
Thank you, Dean Doan. I know you have information about Louis Andriessen in your program, so I won't go over that. But let me just say that almost by definition, the 24 composers who have won this award are the absolute pinnacle of their profession. But every so often, the winner is not merely one of the world's greatest composers, but someone of legendary stature, one that other composers look on with something very like awe and reverence. Louis Andriessen is certainly one of that number, an elite among the elites, and I am thrilled to have him with us. It has also been a pleasure to get to know him this week and discover that he is a warm, kind, thoughtful, wise, and funny human being. Our composition students have been taking lessons with him this week and have also had a chance to socialize with him on an informal basis. I know that they are finding this experience invaluable, something unique to the University of Louisville, and I know that they're having lots of fun doing it as well. Joining us today from the President's office is Provost Shirley Willingant, who will present the award, and then Mr. Andriessen will speak to us about his winning work, the multimedia opera, La Commedia.
Simple. I'm going to thank a lot of people for why I'm here. The ending is, to the contrary, very complicated because we had planned to show you a part of the edited DVD of the performance edited by the filmmaker, Hal Hartley, and it seems not very clear why, but it seems that the promised CD perhaps arrived, but is in any case completely tracelessly disappeared at the university. I have the feeling that it must be one of the demons which play a role in the opera, of course. Let's put it that way. That is the best solution. Now, apart from this, we will see what we are going to do. I'm going to explain it after having thought that I would like to thank so many people who have together made me stand here. First of all, I'm very honored and grateful for the Grawemeyer Award, who more than what your dean has told you, as far as I can control, the highest composition prize in the world is for one composition. Really the highest. Unless you know better, please tell me, but I have my doubts about you will succeed in passing it. So that's very beautiful. I know from Mark a lot about the way of structuring how to find the right piece for the prize, how complex and how democratic and how beautiful this has been done in different layers and different states. I have to thank a lot of people who have thought and gave attention to the composition. And I must say that I'm extremely happy with the fact that it is this piece and not another piece. And that has, I suppose, all kinds of special reasons, which part of them I want to share with you. First of all, I consider the piece as a kind of autobiography, if I may say so, or memoirs. Memoirs is a little bit really old man. I'm very old, but not as old as to write the memoirs. But the autobiography makes some sense because I have the feeling that I profit from a lot of things I have done in my life in this piece. Strange enough, I have the feeling that I also have to thank Dante himself, who was already in the 70s a large inspiration for me to think at the highest level about composing. I have to thank the performers of the piece also. Without the singer who does the role of Dante, I think I would have never dared to write a piece like this on this text, because she is Italian, and I think writing for somebody who sings her or his mother language is for composers very important, and in a way Dante and Italian is one thing. We should realize that the book is written in the early 1300s, so most of you were not born yet then, I suppose. It's a really long time ago. But it is a period in which a lot of things have happened in Europe. But what is important, of course, is to, and I'm going to advise you to do that, because he's probably one of my the most important inspiration for the whole piece, is the fact that the book is much more than you think. It's about almost everything. That is what I want to explain about the form, and then what I decided to do with it. And then we get into the more complicated and improvised part of this little hour we have, because of the lack of the presence of the DVD. Now we can do two things, and Mark, if you don't mind, I made a kind of decision. What we did find here at the university was a group of short movies of Hal Hartley. And one of the titles I do recognize is called Implied Harmonies. I think, but I'm not completely sure, so that's why I would advise you to say yes to my idea to start showing the movie, DVD, and see how far we come. Of course, at 3 hours 50 we will stop and you can go to your lesson or to your class or to, I don't know, beer drinking or whatever. Probably right in the middle of the film. But I don't worry too much about it because the film is about a short half an hour. And I suppose when I don't talk too much, then you will see me talk, because I think this film, Implied Harmonies, is a kind of the making of the opera, and a conversation between me and Hal Hartley, and probably some other people which I forgot. I only saw a raw montage just around the time that we did the premiere of the opera. But it's a very slight chance that it's a little birthday present I got from Hal Hartley, and that is much shorter. So he probably has made that a longer film, and that is a very strange film about two kind of young people sitting in a poor little room somewhere downtown New York, and the girl is watching in a map of New York, and has all these Dutch names, Peter Stuyvesant, and then the guy sitting somewhere on a coach, and what do you worry about all these Dutch names here in the city? So it's a quite funny little happening, I would say. I'm not sure. I think it's a good idea to, at a certain moment, you should make me stop talking about the opera and about Dante and when it's time to watch the making of, which I think it is. We never know. Now, Dante, apart from being working in the 1300s in Italy, he did work a long time, several years, much more than I did for writing the opera, which took me 4 years, really 4 years. I mean, every day composing, Saturday composing, Sunday composing, holidays composing, of course. So that is a lot of work, but I think Dante took much more time for writing this large trilogy, which is a poem, and it's a very strictly organized poem. It's almost like a serial composer who only can use numbers. There's a lot of numbers. Of course, the magical number is 3. The book so-called book. It's called La Divina Commedia, not because that was the name Dante gave it, but he did not give it a name. He wrote to a friend, who asks him, how are you doing with the last poetry? And he said, I am now somewhat halfway with my comedy, La Mia Commedia. So we learned two things. First of all, that the divine is an adjustment of 100 years later, so it's not from Dante, and that he sees it as a theater thing, as a kind of play. And I think that's, at that time, Commedia already meant, can be a dramatic play too, but as long as it has a happy ending, then you may call it a comedy. So this is very important, I think, for people to know. And then immediately the next thing I want you to know is that this large poem is actually about everything. There are several very important subjects, but actually every subject, all hobbies you have, you will find back in your book. But the main subjects, I would say, and probably not in the first place, the religion, I think that is a very important subject, of course. Probably it's the third most important. The first most important, I think, is love. The love poetry in La Commedia is probably the most beautiful ever written. And probably you remember the story that Dante fell in love with a very young girl who actually was engaged with a very nice Florentine. You know? And not only that, I think she married him, and then the poor girl died of some disease which was happening quite regularly in this very unhealthy period in world history. He idealizes her, and she is the first example of an object of what we now would call a romantic being in love with someone. That is what happens in the structure, because there are three books which are more or less the same length, 33 cantos, tercinen, sets of three, also the number three becomes very important, in which are divided into the three places where a human mankind seems to be present, to put it that way, and which is, of course, he starts in hell. Then he goes to the purgatory, and which is a very complex thing to define. And finally, this is the big trip he makes, he arrives in heaven. Now, we can have long discussions about the religious aspect. It's very evident that not only all the religious figures we know got in the first place, but a lot of other holy and saints are playing very important roles in the book. However, he was interested already as an intellectual in the heavy theological discussions which were held in that period in Catholic Italy. So that's a very important subject as a second subject. But probably the most important, I'm not sure, we can discuss that if you like. I think Dante would be happy if I would say that. The problem with Dante was that he was very active in the political fights and the struggles and the argumenti, as you may say, in his time in Florence, which was a state. At that time, there was no Italy yet. There were different town, city states, probably you call it. And there were big problems. For instance, how do we react upon the hierarchy and the importance of the power of the Pope? It was a very heavy subject. So heavy that at a certain moment, Dante has been banned from the city by the ruling, at this moment, the ruling families. And he has taken that very seriously. He has never come back to the city and lost family, of course, friends, everybody you can imagine who was important. And at that time, you didn't go to an hotel and had some friends who paid you stay. No way. He had to travel from city to city to keep alive, in a way. It's not very clear. And in this international situation, for a cosmopolitan situation, he took the time to write the poem. And this is very evident when you start reading it, because in hell, of course, you find a lot of terrifying people and a lot of devils who have all different names also. There are upper devils and lower devils, all kinds of devils. And actually, we should not forget that they are fallen angels, of course. I hope I don't have to explain too much about that, because to study Dante means to study a lot of Orthodox theology, of course. Now, there are a lot of devils around, but who are the most important people in hell, of course, are all his enemies in Florence. So they are all living people at the time he is writing it. And he really says very bad things about all these people. They are all gangsters, which they are probably now in the same way when we think of the president of the state of Italy, for instance. So that didn't change too much for me in this sense, but there are an enormous amount of very bad people in hell, which are all his contemporaries in Florence. More people like that. Also, historical bad people are there. A lot of very interesting people, as you know. And you have, of course, greats in hell too. You have really very bad, or not very bad, but still bad, etc. It's a whole system of shortcuts, of course. Then, of course, passing through Purgatory, which is a little bit more peaceful situation. Finally, he will arrive in heaven. Strange enough, he doesn't see too much because the light is overwhelming. He can't see too much, and he always faints all the time also. Luckily, he has finally found in heaven, of course, because Beatrice is there. He meets her. But the whole voyage he has done under the guidance of the Roman poet Virgil, because of Beatrice, who is went out of heaven to go down to ask Virgil, where is he in fact? That's interesting. I didn't know that. And to ask him to guide Dante on his difficult trip through the three stages. Now, you can imagine when you read this, I read it in the 70s, then I reread it in the late 80s, early 80s, 90s. And then I met the singer, who is the first singer since I worked with Catherine Berrien in the 70s, who is able to show, I would say, 100 different faces of personages. She's able to sing in different styles. She is able to act, she's able to dance. She started as a dancer, she is Italian, she can improvise, act, everything. She was an amazing personality, and she certainly inspired me to write the whole work. Not only that, there's another woman who is important, who is the woman I lived with for a long time, and who died during my composing of the work. And the whole work is dedicated to her too. And she has, there are all kinds of connections which I would have liked to explain to you while you could listen, see and listen to the first part. But I think it's more interesting for you to watch the funny DVD. But what is, now you know a little bit about the large structure, incredibly difficult is to decide what shall I do to make it something which is your thing and which homage gives an homage to the work. And after rereading it, the second time, I started to make notes of things which I had a personal connection with, and throughout the whole book, and then I started again checking my notes and taking out of the notes even less than once. And then I had a kind of idea what this I want to deal with in my piece. And this, the whole thing took about 4 years, so you can imagine that you have a lot of time to take not only decisions, but also to reflect your decisions and decide to change it into etc. When you have, you don't believe people who say, no, I have no time to read books, I have no time to do this. It's always a lie because they don't want to do that. And you have to make time for actually everything that you want to do well. It's very simple advice, but it seems to be necessary from time to time to give that as a one-liner. So make time yourself. It's an important thing to do. And then, when you do that, then you learn also to stop working and to take your free time also. Very important, don't forget that. And it's very difficult for people to stop working when it goes well. Well, that's lesson two. Stop when it goes well, that you, when you start the next morning or the evening, whatever you like, then you are not stuck. Because when you stop, you are stuck. The next morning, you are still stuck, of course. So that doesn't make very much progress. All little advices. You know, you can use them, but not throw them away. Having said this, then the most important and difficult decision which I made, I won't talk too long about, is I decided, and don't ask me why, to write a 5-part opera. And that helped me a lot in dividing the different ideas I want to do. And I especially looked for titles for the 5. So like 5 children, you have to give names. It's very important. There was another hero around, which I want just to mention you, because I will come back to the subject hopefully in a few years, was the Dutch painter, who you probably call Jeronimus Bosch, right? We say Jeroen Bosch. And he is a very strange painter, a kind of surrealist painter of very small paintings, and not more than 20 or 30. And two of the five titles have titles of names of paintings of Jeroen. Like the first one was called the Ship of Fools, you call that, a little ship with nuns and priests, and they have heavy weather, and so a very funny little painting. And Pile 4, which is the light, easy growing Sunday afternoon part, is called the Garden of Earthly Delights, which is a beautiful large triptych, you probably remember, of people who are all very happy and kissing each other and have fun and beautiful gardens and fountains. The world looks really like the way it should do, unless you close the two doors, and then we get into a totally different, like hell and other sort of quite contrasting scenes. That was the part I would like to listen to, but as I said, I think as soon as possible we should see what Hal Hartley did bring to the university, as for short movies. The problem of the whole thing is that I saw the whole opera not as a staged opera only, but as a film opera. I had always in mind that there should be different layers about the whole structure, different time periods also. And because of my experiences with film in larger theater works, I did meet at a certain moment, I had the possibility to make a little video for the BBC, and I asked a young, sort of young New York filmmaker, Hal Hartley, to think about making this little video, and then help me thinking about a large extra layer on film for the staging of the whole Commedia, which worked out. And that's very, very good to know, but less relevant for you to know when you don't have the images to see. But it was very interesting to deal with the three protagonists which I had, and there's a little choir, like in operas of Steve Reich, or operas, larger vocal works, let's say, which my generation started not to work with a large choir, but with solo voices and the microphone. That is in a sort of pit. There is not a real pit in the Commedia. And then, apart from that, there are actually three protagonists and one, a few very small little side roles. And those two protagonists, I think I decided already in a very early stage, because I had in mind three persons to ask to do it. Of course, the first of all you should mention is Beatrice, who, as you know, is in heaven. So the first thing I explained to Hal that I needed at least a place high in the ceiling of the theater where Beatrice is present, because she is there and she lives in heaven. And she has a white shirt on, as you remember, of all the beautiful pictures from all the contemporaries, Giotto and other ones in Italy. That's one. Then the second one is, of course, Dante. Actually, Christina, I call her in the score also, the Italian singer I told you about. And then there is one man, and where I didn't talk about yet to you, is actually the central figure, literally the central figure, the only man which is really important in the piece, who has, like the other girls, also a sort of double role, the role in the score and the role in the film. That's very interesting, that they are totally different people, except in what you see, because the sort of costume is the same. Now, the man, maybe as short as I can be, shows up sometime. In the film, he shows up, in any case, it's more clear, as a kind of gangster, money maker, real estate person, and he deals with this group of sort of street musicians, which are a kind of gang running around in Amsterdam, and he is paying them to get out of prison. It's a funny role, but very important is that on the stage he is Lucifer, because Lucifer, to my surprise, doesn't play a very important role in the Dante at all. There are a lot of devils, but there is not a kind of super devil who is basically responsible for why angels became devils. Now, I'm not going to tell you the whole story, but Lucifer was the one who said to God, I think your idea to create human beings is not a very good idea. Angels are much better succeeding what you want as things or objects or beings who can admire you. Now, this, as you know, is went completely the wrong direction, and he has been sent out after a fight with a leader, not Gabriel, but Michael, thrown out of heaven. And when you do that with really important people, of course they fall on earth and they sink through the bottom of earth into where, as you know, hell is, right in the middle of the earth. Now, it was difficult because there was no upper devil in the book, and I needed him really because I sort of, I don't know, I think it's, I can't really have any explanation for that. So my assistant said, who has studied the Dutch language, have you checked Vondel? And Vondel is the Dutch Shakespeare in the 1600s, and he did write amazing plays also, and two of them are about the subject Lucifer. The first one is called Lucifer, and it's about the fight in heaven with his fellows, angels. The second one, which is the one I used most in my opera, is called Adam in Exile, and it's about the revenge, of course, of Lucifer in hell. And that is, of course, a subject which is a very important part of the whole subject. And the five parts, sort of hand like this, we go down from the message from Beatrice to Virgil and the request of Maria and Martha in heaven to ask for to help Dante do the trip. We go down to the central part of the third part where Lucifer starts explaining about, in Dutch in fact, old Dutch, medieval Dutch, 1600s. Lucifer starts to explain about what is wrong and what went wrong and what will always go wrong. And then we go up passing purgatory, and that's the part I wanted to show you. Listen to, which is the final, some quietness, final some peace, and some sunny afternoon feeling, whatever you have in mind for that, up to the last part, which is not called Paradiso, but Luce Eterna, which is, I think, probably the most important subject of Paradiso, is the light. But it's strange enough, what his conclusion is that the light is so strong that you can't see really things. So it's all over here. That's a very interesting way of thinking and making your philosophy about all these important subjects, of course. This is the five parts. I think I have been clear enough about it now too. In the movies, you'll see the man is the kind of gangster, as I told you already. And in the last, in Luce Eterna, in the Paradiso of Dante, shows up a forefather who starts complaining a list of bad things in Florence again, right in heaven. That's very strange, because we remember that from the first part in Dante. And this is also, for composers, very interesting that you may be at a completely different situation, but suddenly there is this part of your consciousness and your historical philosophy, whatever, to find something back from your youth, for instance, or from what you have heard an hour ago. Memory is a very interesting element and point to talk about when you create larger works of arts, also in painting. So he shows up in the movie, the actor who did Lucifer, and the gangster in the film. He shows up as this Pachacuera, who is this man who starts complaining really like gangsters do about all their colleagues that they have to be shot at. And he has a very strange conclusion, which is also took from Dante, is that he says, well, we can talk about all these people, but we know they are bad people, but they are not very important. You are important. The fact that you are writing this text, that is very important and will make you immortal and will be studied 100 years later. Actually, so this whole Pachacuera in heaven is a kind of, I would say, advertisement for himself, for Dante. I like that too. That's a good reason to have Pachacuera around in an opera on my Commedia. So what I forgot to tell about is that Beatrice in the opera, in the version we did, is an American singer who, in the movie, they say Beatrice, she doesn't come out of her cage at all, in fact. In the movie, she is a kind of diplomat or an ambassador from a sort of far country, also in white, of course, in the film. And what happens is that she's visiting Amsterdam for some important reason, because she's followed by by Christina, who is a kind of Italian hip TV journalist, something like that, very active in things. And in the fourth part, there's the only really dramatic moment where everything comes together, that we suddenly see that Claren, as the name of Beatrice in the meal, turning around looking, and this we have seen her in a Mercedes, you could pronounce that, I suppose, large expensive car, and she's on the and Christina's on the street, and suddenly the very effort is overruled by the car, this Mercedes. And it's a very dramatic moment, actually the only real dramatic, strange dramatic moment in the opera. Just before we go up, now you know almost everything you can know about, except that you didn't hear the music, that's very strange. Well, we have 10 minutes for the film. Shall we do that? Thank you for listening until now. I probably stay in the neighborhood if to where necessary explain everything which can go wrong still. Of course, this is the part of my life. Good composers can know very well how to handle improvised situations.
I hope.
In flat harmonies, right? In flat harmonies?
Well, I don't know the take, I think the second one. Have a look, Mark. It's implied harmonies, that's the title. Have you sound?
Dear Mademoiselle, thank you for forwarding my mail. I will meet Andriessen this afternoon to discuss the opera he wants me to stage. As with other artists I meet who are a generation or more older than me, I want to know about his evolution, the changes he went through, and if, at the time, he knew he was going through them.
Well, I think there are two things. There are some points like that. I will give a few examples. But before that, I have the feeling that, I don't know why exactly, that I always liked to do something which I had not done before. Sort of an idea what I later found is that you have two kinds of artists. I think it was Isaiah Berlin who came up with that idea. The foxes and the hedgehogs, you could name?
Hedgehogs.
The foxes are the ones who run around and look around and take what they steal what they can steal and do their own thing. And the hedgehogs are the ones who grave in deeper all the time in one direction. The Schoenbergs, we call them. I call them. And the foxes are, of course, when you keep the same generation, are the Stravinskys. Now, of course, it's more complicated, but I have the feeling if I had to choose between the two, then I am Stravinsky.
The opera is to be called La Commedia, and it is very loosely based on the Divine Comedy of Dante. But but it also has large pieces of text from the 16th century Dutch playwright Vondel, which I need as well.
Actually, halfway in the 60s, I started using quotations in different style elements and so on, which were then very, in the meantime, jazz was very important, also by, because of a brother who came out from America with all kinds of recordings, 78 records at that time, and he brought stuff which we had never heard of, all kinds of things from America, and came from Cage to Bernstein, let's say. And then, in the early 70s, being jazz-oriented already for a long time. I remember the first recordings of Steve Reich, for instance, from 68, 69. Very exciting and totally new. It was a funny combination. What they did with what then Steve already called repetitive music, strangely, what I called very avant-garde combination of an extremely avant-garde idea about time, namely very long and almost no development, which is Cajun also in a way, and the pulse rhythm of popular music. That was very interesting. And that was another step forward for me to jump into this new American stream, which I found much more interesting than the more and more complex 12-tone Schoenberg-oriented developments in Europe, still nowadays.
My set designer and I saw the Janáček opera the other night, Katya Kabanova. Truly staggering sentimentality. We tried to escape after 10 minutes, but they would not open the doors. There was no intermission. We were forced to watch the whole thing. What does not kill you, my friend, will make you tougher.
Louis knew I did not like opera, and he said, I'm writing a new opera, and I want you to stage it. And I said yes, because I wanted to get to know him.
This is where two of the most important points to find myself when we talk about really composing. There are all the social things around too, and how to do what I think I should do. And I think that my approach to theater has been as important as that too, to deal always with people who have another kind of approach towards music and are more fashion oriented also, the directors and the filmmakers, and that's another world in effect.
I only come to understand now, I mean, his whole body of work from his youth has been in collaboration with, theater, opera, dance, and so I risked it. But luckily, as time went on, I realized that what he had composed was not really an opera. It's a group of five big songs.
Big news, our venue has changed. We are no longer to perform in the Musique Theater, which was a good place to show our widescreen movie, and we are moved to Carré, a very interesting old circus theater. It is not a good place to watch a movie, at least not a single movie, but it could be a good place to show five movies at once. Story Louis seems to believe his opera conveys, but he is always encouraging.
Don't get a chance to work with a real filmmaker sometimes, but most of the times, or at least very often, there are films involved, or images, videos, so you get filmed. So being, of course, even if just for a few seconds, being filmed actually gives you a chance to ignore the problem of performing the music and being completely focused on something different.
The characters in the piece are the characters in the Commedia, and at the same time you have a sort of another story that's going on in the film. So it's this link between the characters in the film. You have the guild, I believe you call it the guild, that you don't have in Dante. Well, as far as I know, they're not in Dante's Commedia. But so there's this relationship and a link between what's happening on the screen, the characters and their story, and the story that's going on the stage.
Simply from a very stupid thing where you don't have to suffer for. I should not, because I have some experience of the fact that more than before, and it has to do with Dante, I had images in my mind myself. This is fatal, of course. For a collaboration, this is fatal.
When he saw the motion pictures I have made. They're nothing like what he imagined.
The funny thing is, I always thought, because of Casella, who is described as working outside, sort of outside, so the outside was okay, but I had, for some strange reason, something green in mind, so meadows, Monet, this kind of thing.
Cueing them